If you'll go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 28. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28. And I want us to read the Great Commission, verses 19 and 20. Matthew's Gospel. Of course, these two verses are above my head in the version that I'm going to be reading here. Matthew 28, verse 19. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything that I've commanded you. And remember, I'm with you always to the end of the age. Before we pray, I want to give you a definition, or I believe a great biblical definition of what baptism is, and what we in this church, along with all of the Southern Baptist churches, believe that baptism is. I want to give you an extremely good definition here. And then I will, as we go through this sermon, I hope that we can understand a little bit more about what this definition means as we break it apart a little bit. But it is, baptism is the immersion or the dipping of a believer in water, symbolizing the complete renewal and change in the believer's life and testifying to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ as the way of salvation. Let me read that to you one more time. Baptism is the immersion or dipping of a believer in water, symbolizing, that word symbol is very important, symbolizing the complete renewal and change in the believer's life and testifying to the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ as the way of salvation. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Father, we come to you, God, and so often our understanding of baptism, Lord, is not exactly what it should be. And so, Lord, I hope and pray, and this is my prayer, it's been my prayer all week, that somehow, Lord, we truly understand what baptism is about, Lord, that there's no more confusion when we're finished here today about what it means. Because, Lord, there is so much confusion out there, Lord. And in no way, Lord, are we trying to slight anyone else who has a different view. But, Lord, I believe biblically that this is what it is. And I pray, God, that as those who are listening today in the sound of my voice, that they will hear, Lord, and each person in their own language will receive what they need to understand. And, Lord, make this understanding clear to us, Lord. Help us to see, we pray. Let your Holy Spirit so rain down upon us, Lord. Be with us, we pray. In Jesus' name. Today, God has blessed us with three individuals who are coming this morning to unite with this church in believers' baptism. I had the privilege Friday to baptize one of the people that will be standing before you out at the lake on Swanson. I know it's cold at this time of year. She was brave. I actually wore some waders, and so I wasn't quite as brave. And we went out in the water, and she was baptized there. So one individual has already been baptized, and we have three this morning that are coming to be baptized. And so I want us to understand a little bit more about what that means. Now, over the years, I've had the opportunity to be involved in a part of a number of baptisms, ranging from my own to my children, to those or that others have led to Christ, to those that I've had the privilege, the great opportunity to lead to Christ. But it's always a joyous time. It is a great time of rejoicing to see people come to be baptized. The unfortunate thing, as I've already said, is that many misunderstand the meaning of baptism. They have a false understanding of what it really is and what it really means for an individual. Well, I hope this morning, by the power of the Holy Spirit, not my power, not my strength, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, to bring some clarity to this quite often misunderstood ordinance. And I'd like you to see who and what baptism is not for, as you clearly see who and what baptism is for. Now, before we delve in to these 2 points, I want to clarify that we believe that the only proper mode of baptism is immersion, is going under the water. We must root our convictions in the Bible and the Bible only. Now, the Greek word baptizo means immersion. It doesn't mean anything else. Baptizo, that Greek word where we get the word baptism from, means immersion. It doesn't mean any other form of baptism. But something of even greater importance is the fact that only immersion can picture the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, or the believers dying to sin and rising to a new life. We do not believe that sprinkling is baptism. And I hope that doesn't offend anyone this morning, but we do not believe that that is real baptism, as this word in the Greek is baptizo, which means immersion. So back to our first main point, who and what baptism is not for. Well, it is not for unbelievers. It's not for you if you're an unbeliever, if you have never truly trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Baptism is not for you. It's not for someone who is unregenerate or has never truly been born again or born of above. Baptism is not for them. And you might say, well, Paul, we understand that. Why are you telling us that? I don't think everyone understands that. I have people who think they can come to me and get in that water, and somehow maybe I get the water from some other source or something, or I pray over and it becomes magical or something, and if they just dip themselves in that water that they'll be saved. People really believe that. That's not what the Bible teaches at all. Baptism, and we'll get to that here in a moment, what it is for, what it is. It is for saved people and not unbelievers. It's also not for infants. It is not for infants. The Roman Catholic Church and some Protestant denominations practice what we call infant baptism. Also, some churches teach that the rite of baptism in and of itself has the power to regenerate sinners when performed by the church. Of course, the Bible doesn't teach that. They believe that no child goes to heaven without baptism by the church. However, I will say this, the Roman Catholic Church does not regard this salvation as final. Rather, it begins this lifelong process of moving toward a final salvation through believing in Christ, attending the Mass, and participating in the various sacraments of the church. Lutherans believe that baptism does not necessarily save the child, but that the Spirit can work faith in infants through the gospel promise connected with water baptism, just as it does in adults. Some Reformed Calvinist churches teach that baptism is analogous to, and it expands this covenantal sign of circumcision, and therefore covenant baptism in this view connects a child to the larger covenant community, and it places this dependence on God to later confirm this sign by bringing this person to Christ. Here, baptism has to do with the faith of the parents. The faith of the church has nothing to do with the faith of that child. It is not saving in of itself. Another argument for infant baptism is that whole households are recorded as being baptized together in the New Testament. However, if you notice in those scriptures, never does it tell us that there was an infant involved in those household baptisms. Baptizing believing children is not the same as baptizing an infant who cannot pray to receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, those who are not old enough to have faith in Christ. It is different when we baptize a child. And I have one this morning coming to us to be baptized, and she was able to sit with me in the office, and we were able to talk about who Christ Jesus is and what it means to repent. And she repented there and believed upon Jesus Christ, and she is coming to be baptized, and all obviously an infant cannot do that. The Bible does not teach infant baptism. It also does not teach something that you're probably not, you probably don't know as much about. Baptism for the dead. The Bible does not teach baptism for the dead. According to Paul the Apostle, some Christians at Corinth denied that the resurrection of the dead. They denied that after someone died, that at some point they would be resurrected. And so Paul is dealing with this. He saw this, as we would see this today, as serious, serious error. If there is no resurrection from the dead, I think all of us know the next thought, then Christ Jesus was not resurrected, and so therefore there is no salvation for anyone. And Paul is saying, my preaching means nothing if there's not a resurrection, and your faith is null and void. Because if there is no resurrection, Jesus Christ wasn't resurrected. And if Jesus Christ wasn't resurrected, then how can you be saved? And Paul is dealing with this. And Paul argued in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 for the reality of the resurrection of the dead. And as part of his argument here, he mentioned a practice of some of the people at Corinth. That is the practice of baptizing the dead. And if you ever want to look that up, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 29, and this is where Paul talks about this baptizing the dead. Now, there are two things that are extremely important that you hear here about this. I want you to note this. First, we are not sure exactly what is entailed in the practice of baptizing for the dead. An early church father, he explained the practice of an early Christian group of hiding a living person under the stand for a casket of a dead person. So you have a casket here, and you have the stand underneath it, and this person is hiding underneath that stand of that casket with that dead person inside. Now the corpse would be approached and asked if he or she would like to be baptized. The person hiding underneath would answer in behalf of the corpse that he desired to be baptized, and then the living person would be baptized for the dead person. It's possible that something like this was going on and being practiced in Corinth that Paul is dealing with here. Paul was not in any way, please understand this, advocating the practice of baptizing for the dead. Paul was merely pointing out to the inconsistency in the thought of these Corinthians in trying to convince them of the reality of the resurrection of the dead. The argument seems to be from Paul, this is his argument, if as some of you Corinthians claim there's no resurrection of the dead, then why in the world are you baptizing people who are dead? That doesn't make any sense. If you don't believe that there's a resurrection, then why would you baptize someone who's dead? Only those who hope for life after death would attempt to influence the eternal fate of those who died. You thinking, Paul is saying this, you thinking on the subject is contradictory. You claim there's no resurrection, but your actions betray that you really believe that something is going on or something will happen after death or after this life. Other Bible students think the Corinthians believed life in the spirit made the body unnecessary, and baptism for the dead in this view ensured the dead would enjoy the same spiritual life as with the living, but without a body. So we see here that baptism is not for someone who is unregenerate, someone who is not a Christian, not a true born-again believer. It's also not for infants who cannot make a decision for Christ. It's also not for the dead. And finally, baptism is not a requirement for salvation. It is not required for salvation. Think of the thief on the cross. Jesus said, "Today you will be with me in paradise," and that thief never came off of that cross to be baptized. So it is not a requirement for salvation, but it is a requirement for obedience. It is the first step of obedience for the believer, but it does not save the individual. Someone who is truly born again, that's your first step of obedience to Christ, is to be baptized. But it does not, please understand that, it does not save you. And we'll get into that a little bit here more. So we've investigated what baptism is not, or at least some of who or what baptism is not for. Now let's see what baptism is, or what baptism is for. So baptism is an ordinance that symbolizes the believer's identification with Jesus Christ in his death, in his burial, and his resurrection, and it symbolizes the believer's cleansing from sin. Now catch that word symbol. It is a symbol. It's not a saving factor. It is a symbol. Romans 6, 3 and 4. With that word symbol in your mind, listen to these verses. I've got three verses here, or three different passages. It says here, Romans 6, 3 and 4, "Or are you unaware that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?" Now, if it was not a symbol, then how in the world are you and I baptized into his death? None of us are there 2,000 years ago. We're all here today. We'd all have to load up and go over into the Middle East and be baptized in that area. Well, that didn't happen, so this is obviously a symbol. Therefore, we were buried. I think any of us have ever been physically buried with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too may walk in a new way of life. Galatians 3:27, "For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ like a garment." I don't think we can physically put Christ on like a garment. Again, it is a symbol. Colossians 2:12 says, "Having been buried with him in baptism, you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead." And none of us have been raised from the dead in a physical sense. So again, these are symbols, or it is a symbol of what's happened in your life. The baptized object or person becomes identified with whatever it is dipped or immersed in. Just as a cloth that is immersed in some form of dye, it will be always marked by that dye. It's the same thing with baptism. In Scripture, baptism carries the idea of identification or association with a person, a group, or a message. Romans 6:4 again. Let me read that again. It shows that baptism symbolizes identification with Christ. "Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in a newness of life." Through water baptism, Christians represent their association with Christ in his death for their sin, in his burial, and his resurrection. Through baptism, believers testify that they have risen to new life with Christ. Henry Thiessen points out that water baptism does not affect or affect this identification. Rather, it presupposes it and symbolizes it. Now, John's baptism of repentance was associated with the forgiveness of sins, according to Luke 3:3, that says he went into all the vicinity of the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. So is Christian baptism, according to Acts 2:38, that says, "Repent, Peter said to them, and be baptized, each of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Baptism includes this idea of spiritual cleansing or forgiveness of sins. And again, it symbolizes that, it identifies that, but spiritual identification with Christ is still its primary emphasis. The inward spiritual change experienced by a believer in Christ is pictured in a physical, an outward, and a public way through water baptism. That's what the people are going to do this morning. They are symbolizing, or they are showing you, they are professing before you what Christ Jesus has already done in their lives. That he has forgiven them. That he has been raised for their forgiveness. That he died for their sins. They are going to profess that to you as they go into this water. Though Christian baptism is not a condition for salvation, it was the ordinance by which believers were inducted into a local church. Today, we have four precious individuals who have repented of their sin and trusted Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Savior, who desire to come and join this local body of believers to serve and worship alongside this church. One has already received baptism, believers' baptism, but three are coming today to unite with us in believers' baptism. At this time, I would ask that George Atwood, George, if you would come here and stand up front and just face the congregation. If you'll just face the people out there, you can just stand right there. It'll be fine. Leslie, if you will come, and Leslie's daughter, Leslie Smart, and Nadelle Smart, if y'all will come and stand, and you can just stand right here in the middle. And George, if you want to move up just a little bit, you can, well, that's fine. That's fine there. And then Jerry Baird, if you will come forward and just face the congregation there. I wanted to say a little bit, I'm not going to embarrass anyone, but I wanted to say a little bit about what's happened in each person's life here before you this morning. George Atwood came to me probably a month and a half ago, somewhere around that, and asked about joining the church. And he said, I'd like to sit down with you and talk about joining the church. And so him and his brother, they came into my office and sat down with me, and we talked about what it means to join. And of course, I started off talking about salvation, what it means to be saved, to be in Christ. And George felt that he had never really received Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And so there in the office, he prayed to receive Jesus as his Lord and his Savior. He repented of his sin, and this morning he is coming on his profession of faith that Jesus is his Lord to join with us. Now Leslie, and I've mentioned Leslie already, and Leslie is a brave woman. That water is cold now. And she wanted to be baptized out at the lake, and she was saved approximately 2 years ago at her brother's funeral. Now, I want to say this for a moment. I want to say something about funerals. If the gospel of how to be saved is not preached at a funeral, not a good funeral at all. Because this is the after effects of the true gospel being preached at a funeral, is someone gets saved. And I praise the Lord for that. And over this time, within the 2 years, Leslie has moved a little bit, and she went to preachers, and they just never had time to baptize her in a lake. It just never worked out. And so she came to me and asked me if I was willing to do that. And I said, sure, I'm at the lake a lot fishing, and I'd love to go to the lake. And so no problem at all. And so we went out to the lake, and she was baptized there. But she is coming to join us here today. This is her daughter next to her. This is Nadelle. And Nadelle came with her mother to sit down with me and talk about Nadelle's salvation. She prayed in the office to repent of her sin and receive Jesus Christ as her Lord and her Savior. And she has been so excited about being baptized. Every time I see her at Awana or on a Sunday morning, it's been a few weeks now, she's asked me about being baptized. And so this is finally the day, Nadelle. And so I'm excited for her, and she's excited too. And I will not let you fall. She did not want me to let her fall in the water, and that will not happen. We also have Jerry Baird coming here, and praise the Lord for people within the congregation who are out spreading the gospel message, telling others about who Jesus Christ is. And Judy Bainey was able to lead Jerry to the Lord, and he prayed to receive Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior with her. And he's been coming to church, and he is learning. He did not grow up in the church like many of us have. And so he is learning, he is studying, he's excited about the Lord. He's talking about the Lord to those around him. And that's what should be happening for those of us who are Christians, that we're out spreading the gospel message, and he is doing that. But I talked to him last week. I knew that we had these baptisms coming up, and we fill up the baptismal, and I asked him if he wanted to be baptized now, and he said, sure, yes. And he met with us Sunday night, and we met with a member of our church council, and we just gave our testimonies. And so all of these standing before you, George and Adele and Leslie and Jerry, they are coming to unite with us in believers' baptism and to unite with us in this church as members of this church. And for a moment before we welcome them in with a hallelujah, I want to explain a little bit about what being a member means. Being a member of the church, more importantly than just being a member of this local body of believers, when they received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, they became members of the church all around the world. And they are already members of the church. But when you come and join a local body of believers, it also, there's a few things that it does. They have a right to vote when there's something to be voted on in the church, and that's important. I mean, there's not always things that are extremely important to vote on, but sometimes there are. And if you're a member of the church, it gives you a voting right. But more important than that is the opportunity to commit yourself to serving in this church alongside the members of this church and those who are a part of this church. Now, I do want to say this. We love people to come. Even if you're not a member, I don't ever try to force people to be members of the church. You notice I don't say a lot about it unless someone comes to me. But even if you're not a member, that doesn't mean that if you're coming to this church and you're a Christian and you're a member of the church as a whole, that you should not be serving in this church. It doesn't give us a right to serve less. And so we want to all serve the Lord together. There are so many opportunities in this church to serve this church as well as the community. Praise God for that, and they are coming to join us. So if you, like me, receive these precious believers into our fellowship, raise your right hand and shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Luke's going to play a YouTube video from Chris Tomlin. It's called Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone, and how appropriate that is. That's what's happened in these lives here. And so at this time, I'm going to ask if the men will go over here, and we're going to get ready to be baptized, and then the ladies are going to go over here to this side and get Nadelle ready. And so we'll meet in the middle here in a moment. And portion me as long.
as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me.
Dale, on your profession of faith that Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Now, Jerry, on your profession of faith that Jesus Christ is your Lord and your Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now, George, on your profession of faith that Jesus Christ is your Lord and your Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let me pray, and then Bill's going to come and lead us in a closing song. And after Bill finishes the song, you're dismissed. So let me close this in prayer. Heavenly Father, God, we praise you for this day. What a precious day that you have given us. God, you are with us. You are with this church. You are working in marvelous ways. And we pray that it will continue, that this baptismal will be filled up a lot more, that we will see people truly regenerate, born again, and coming to be baptized. We pray that we'll see that, Lord. Thank you for all of those who have given their hearts and their lives to Christ and are new creatures now. Be with them as they grow, Lord, in their faith of who you are and what you mean in their lives. And thank you again for all that you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're singing hymn number 110. O love that wilt not let me go.
Dismissed.